family. Welcome to our rental home.
I'm Diane. I'm the mom. I'm 46.
I'm Jay. I'm the dad, and I'm 46.
I'm Caitlin. I'm 16, and I enjoy music, writing, art, and animals.
I'm Olivia, and I like blowing bubbles and music, and I'm really beautiful, and I'm 7 years old.
I'm 16, and she is, how old are you?
Seven.
This is my room. These are my drawings. They're kind of old, but I like to have them anyway. I know Edward and Bella are there, but they're not really, not as much anymore. And here I have my music station, because I love the music. It's basically my life. I sing and write songs, play the piano. My stuffed animals, I intend on being a vet when I get older. I would like to go to Cornell. I've had this dream since I was in sixth grade. I love penguins. They're basically my favorite animal. I have lots of them. More drawings on the wall there. Some from my friends, and a certificate from when I had my recital last year in piano. So that's pretty important to me. It kind of stinks. I can't have more hanging around, but can't really put holes in the wall. And tape doesn't hold all the posters, so it's kind of tough. But, yeah, I would like to have more posters, favorite bands, Charlie McDonald, Green Day, Sum 41, basically, a little bit of everything. So, this is my room. Here's Olivia. Want to show me this?
Nice room. What's your favorite part about this room? And what do you want to be when you grow up?
A vet.
You want to be a vet? You like animals.
I mostly like cats. There's a toy dragon in this. And some videos on SpongeBob toy. A rocking horse. His name is Rocky. And this is a little thing that I have over there. It's supposed to be on the window. My Nana Rose gave it to me. And here's a stool that opens up. I think. And this opens up like that. And you can pretend this is real makeup. There's some pins in here. Just one pin. There's a beauty thing. I don't know what it is.
You told her about your haircut. Who cut your hair?
Me.
Yay. All right, so this is the dining room, and it's my piano. I got it for Christmas from my mom. And one day I just kind of walked in, and no one was home. And I saw the piano, and I literally started screaming. And I sat down, and I played it instantly. And mom came home in a couple minutes. Tune, but the weight is wrong, so it's a lot harder to play. Like, some of them don't work. The D, completely out, never works. There's broken pieces that should be inside. So the pedals don't work, so the sustain is not good. It suffices, but it would be a lot better if I had an actual piano to play, easier to practice. Songwriting helps when you have keys that are in tune. I really love playing the music, and I know it makes people happy. And it's a lot like how my mom, like with the volunteering that she does and everything, she makes people happy, she helps them, she brightens their lives, she feeds people. It's great to see, kids that come in, especially during the summer when there's no school and they need food, and they have no other source of food to eat. And they come into the Queen's Galley, and they can have three meals a day. So my mom, everything she does. It's really great.
One of the things that she likes that's really near and dear to her is her artwork and her creativity. So something that we're doing today is we're at DSP, Backstage Studio Productions, on Wall Street. It's around the corner from our house at about 2 blocks from the Queens Gallery. And Katie is setting up an art show with a friend of hers, Alejandra Cruz, to show off their talents, but they're also raising money for two really important organizations. First, the Queens Gallery, and then a percentage of what they earn today also will help youth art programs that are run here at BSP. So it's an opportunity to show off their talent and help two great organizations in our area, one specifically for children and the arts, and of course the Queens Gallery.
Hi, this is my passion. These are the things that I make and I sell at the Renaissance Fairs up in the Northeast. My job is working at a wireless company, but I'd like to do this for fun. It's something that I enjoy designing for folks and being creative with it. I don't do as much of it as I'd like to, but we're working towards getting me out of the wireless company and doing more of this. Doublets for ladies. We've got bodices for ladies. We also make corsets. We make them out of a lot of different materials, and we sell them at Renaissance fairs, and we also sell them online.
Hi, we're the Reader family, and we are at our home away from home at the Queens Galley right now, and we're getting ready for the dinner service by rolling some silverware. Tonight we'll see between 100 and 125 guests for dinner. We are open every night, actually every day, for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So there's a lot of different things that go on. Some tasks, as Olivia can do, kids as young as 5 years old can come in and do things like this. In the kitchen, of course, we have our staff and our volunteers that are preparing the meal. Actually, Jay used to come visit me at the restaurant. I was an executive chef over at the Hollowbrook. And it was really, really important to me that the person I was dating liked my food. I guess it was kind of weird. It was one of those, well, the relationship is only going to work if he likes my cooking. So I would ask the busboy and the waiter to bring back his plates so I could see what he left on it. And I noticed that he never ate his vegetables, ever. He still doesn't eat his vegetables. So it's just interesting because I teach a lot of classes for kids, teaching them to eat and choose vegetables, and my husband likes Pop-Tarts and Mountain Dew. We did have to scale back our plans. While we started planning our wedding in 2001 for a 2003 wedding, Olivia decided she was going to be making an arrival also in 2003, and as luck would have it, October of 2003. So some of our plans got scaled back, and including our honeymoon that was supposed to be in Italy. And so we ended up not going to Italy, but we have some great pictures of the place that we were supposed to go to. But you know what? I'd be proud to have Olivia.
In the spring of 2004, Di had a bad case of carbon monoxide poisoning. So she was out of work for a couple of months, and things got really tight. I own my own small business, and it's not a hugely profitable business. It's fun, and I enjoy it, but it wasn't we weren't setting the stars on fire, so to speak. Basically, we were bringing home a couple $100 a month for food, and Di was having to make do with that because she's the cook in the family.
When I woke up one morning and thought that I had had a stroke, I couldn't understand what I read, I couldn't write, couldn't walk without assistance, and we learned a few things about carbon monoxide poisoning, that low doses over a long period of time add up, and the carbon monoxide attaches to your blood cells as if it were oxygen and takes the place of the oxygen that's so critical for your survival. And at some point when your brain just gets tired of being suffocated and not getting the oxygen that it needs, it just shuts down. So when we found this place, it was actually an accident. The building had been for sale, and I thought, wow, it would be really amazing to have some place where the Queens Galley could operate, that we could live in, that Jay Shop could operate out of. I had all these great ideas about what potentially could have been. Then I walk in the building and realize that that's not going to happen. There's people that live here, and, well, Jay was a little skeptical about the building safety and that it was falling short.
It's charitable, it's several decades old, and hasn't been remarkably well maintained, unfortunately. But we thought it would be a good start.
In 2007, opened it up officially as a soup kitchen and homeless shelter. When the soup kitchen had opened, we were serving about 1,200 meals a month. And within a year, that doubled, and now we're serving well over 9,000 meals a month. Now, some things have changed. The fact that we now have a homeless shelter here that houses between 40 and 47 adults at any given time. And, of course, the soup kitchen is much busier than it was when it first opened. But we're still funded the same way, and that's by donation and driven by volunteers.
So, for Diane, the galley is really a passion of hers, being able to feed people, being able to help people. It's great. I enjoy the idea that we're all going to be better to our friends on the planet. We're going to do a better job of helping one another out. But I have a lot of pessimism about it. And with her having that raging optimism that we can reach out to people, that everyone is going to make that connection, really helped me see that, yeah, we could make a difference. I've made donations to various and sundry causes over the year. I'd helped out with auctions and things like that for my business, but I'd never really gotten involved because I had a fundamental disbelief that people really wanted to help one another. I hadn't seen the networking that could happen. And with the Queens Galley, that's something that I've seen happen. It's made me a better person because I've seen the outreach that she's able to do. It's certainly something that's strengthened our marriage as well.
This is the Queens Galley, I guess the heart of the Queens Galley, our dining room and donation center. I know this is just a tiny little corner, but while we're here, we have people that come in that drop off donations, and residents and people from outside can come in and go through this. We try to keep it as orderly as possible, but as you can see, we don't really have storage area to do this or a rack, so we kind of make the best of what we have with that. The dining room. We've recently had some issues with replacing a leak on one end of the roof here. You can see some of the ceiling tiles that are stained or warped that need to be replaced. The floor itself is missing some of the tiles on the floor. And at one point, the way that the dining room floor was sagging, we thought it was actually going to fall through. If you can see where this is all a different color. There was a company that came in and bolstered up from below. The entire foundation area below this was disintegrating. But it doesn't look like it's taking, because if you look here, you can still see where it's starting to separate. So the same issue that we had before is still here. The equipment is old and broken and was never designed to pump out 9,000 meals a month. Tonight they're lucky. We're at the beginning of the month. Food stamps are just starting to come out. So we'll likely only see between 90 and 110 guests tonight for dinner. So the buildings are actually three buildings that are stuck together. Right now we're in building C. It's the newest of the three buildings and probably in the worst shape. I think that's because when the first of the buildings was built 100 years ago, they had been private residences, and the people who had built them, especially Building A, used craftsmen, people who cared about building a structure that would be around as a legacy. And sometimes the newer buildings weren't built with that in mind. And absolutely, certainly, none of these structures were built to be stuck together and to become a homeless shelter and a soup kitchen. So I'll take you for a walk up the stairs here. You can see that, we've painted it or wallpapered, but we can't keep up on it. Right now, the fuel bills that we pay
suck every bit of money out of us. So there isn't anything left over to do things like paint or laundry or make something beautiful. And, you know, people deserve to live someplace beautiful no matter who they are, how much they're making or how much they're not making. This is one of the bathrooms that the plumbing has just completely disintegrated. So in the process of trying to fix that and make it usable again, there are people that live in these bedrooms behind us, and they need to use this bathroom, and right now it is completely unusable.
So the houses, there are so many different kinds of people that live here and have so many amazing stories. And every one of the rooms is different, but they all have something in common, is that they're falling apart. So what I'd like to do is say hello to one of our residents, and she'll tell you a little bit about what's going on in her room. Okay?
How you doing?
Good. This is, well, say hi, ABC.
Hi, ABC. I'm Gina.
This is Gina, and Gina's only been with us for a little while, a couple mm-hmm. months, right?
Yes. Yep.
And so she'll be able to talk to you a little bit about her room here and how really cool it would be to have something not so crummy.
Right. Yes, absolutely. Well, we've got our windows that are broken. When it's winter, when it's cold, it comes right through. Some of them don't open.
We've got the floor too that creaks, and it doesn't feel safe. It really doesn't, and our doors need to be replaced. Out here, we need a bathroom desperately. Desperately, the plumbing and everything. We definitely need the bathroom.
Welcome to the room that we call a library. Recently, the Junior League came in and redid this room. Painted it, they put up some curtains, rearranged some bookshelves. So what we have here is an opportunity for guests or into the dining room or residents here to come in, choose a book, keep it, take it, bring books back if they want. There's a children's area, and it also serves as our meeting room when we have our board meetings. And there are NA and AA meetings that are twice a week, and sometimes this room is used for that. When the groups are larger, then of course we use the dining room for those.
Ayla, you want that? Sorry, it's sticky on the end.
No, go on.
You have glasses. Oh, you think it's
called
Papa
and Tyson
Harry.
No,
it's
Ham. Oh,
Tyson!
Watch your back. Let's look at that.